with a syringe, and we had a urine tomorrow for a job or probation, they wouldn't know that he did 2 Oxycontins and I did 2 bags of heroin. We would just test positively high for opiates.
And this is still a huge problem in Charlestown.
Huge problem in Charlestown. If you walk on the street, they look like zombies.
Yeah, we can go out there right now.
We can go out there right now.
So, Brendan, this is asking you, there's no romance to this story. As a lot of Charlestown's things can sort of be romanticized, even though we know it's violent and it doesn't pay off. This takes it to a horror film.
It brings this film, you know, I'm so lucky to be attached to it, but this film brought it to another level. You know, talking about it and, you know, meetings and all that stuff is great. You know, whatever works for you. But this film is going to come across, and that's why we were so lucky to have Peter Looney and Charlestown Against Drugs on board to get the message across. And this film, in my mind, and then John as well, and anyone who was attached to the film, whether it was from crew to actors up, can really contest to the fact that this is going to bring a different light to it, that it's not... you know, this ain't the early 90s kind of like Ben Affleck's movie where you're robbing banks and everybody's driving big Cadillacs and making money.
Or Scarface where
exactly.
You're with the funny cocaine on your
exactly.
nose
right.
and a hail of gunfire, but
this, yeah, this,
not learning a thing.
This isn't, yeah. You know, those days of Charlestown are pretty much over and done, and basically throughout the country, you know, over and done. You know?
And so for your background, you guys have known each other your whole lives. This is your first film. Is that
my
right?
first film, yes.
Yeah, Brendan actually ended up in the film in a very ironic way. Brendan is a generation ahead of me. David Burns, who plays my brother in the film, he was on The Real World and MTV. He was one of the few kids like us to escape Charlestown. He was an awesome tennis player. He ended up leaving Charlestown, but very lucky. He went to VMI. Ended up on MTV's Real World. He's been traveling the world ever since doing crazy things.
A tennis scholarship.
Tennis
a kid
scholarship.
From, a kid from the projects getting a tennis scholarship to a military school. I mean, it's unheard
of. We have you here. Your background's pretty amazing.
The reason he ended up in the film was he's best friends with David. I'm like David's little brother. I said, we're doing prison scenes. I've been in prison, but I also want Brendan on as a prison consultant to make it very authentic and very real. At the last minute, about 3 weeks before we go into production, Tim Sylvia, who's playing the character of Monster in the movie, he's the 5-time heavyweight champion of the UFC, calls me and says, Johnny, I'm doing your movie no matter what, but I can only be there 11 days. Can we make it work? I said, sure, we can make it work, because I'm going to make it work. So in 24 hours, I rewrote my script and added a new character. I gave him the character of Tim Sylvia and wrote Tim Sylvia in as a whole new character. Mm-hmm. And everyone was so nervous that Brendan wasn't going to be able to do this. Why are you bringing your friends in? Brendan spent 11 years in federal prison, okay? Brendan is not going to be afraid of cameras, people. I know that in my heart.
So let's talk about that since we've got to. How are you spending 11 years? And
well, my background is a little different than John's. John's, I actually missed the whole OxyContin craze, which... in a good way, you know, that's the positive I take of being in prison, is that I actually missed it because I probably would have got mixed up. I know I would have got mixed up in it, and who knows, if I might not even be sitting here today, you know, because that's just how deep I was into the drug world before, you know, I went away.
But you weren't sent into prison for drugs.
No. And I went away for robbing armored trucks when I was 18, and I came home when I was 28. So... my lifestyle is, that's why I can relate with the Ben Affleck movie. So I understand that early 90s stuff that he's doing. But, you know, in a way, he's glorifying it. And don't get me wrong, it's, you know, I root for Ben Affleck. He's a local kid, you know, whatever. I love what he does, and I love that he's doing Boston stuff and everything. But in a way, it's glorifying that. And when kids see that, you know, because these kids in the neighborhood still to this day still see that stuff. And they look up to people like that. So, in a way, it is glorifying, and it's going to keep that trend going in a certain way. But
it's still your mark of status, like you said.
Right. You know, and our film is two different things. You know, we're not glorifying it. You know, and that's why when I first wrote the script and John asked me, would you be interested in doing this? I said, sure, because I like the fact that it's not glorifying the OxyContin, you know, lifestyle. It's telling the downfalls, losing people, friends, ODing, you know, and it's like someone dies and you're so messed up, you know, you're so fucked up on drugs, you'll bet, you know, John would die, say, on the street, and me and him could be best friends. And it, the next day, I'd skip his wake and go find OxyContin. That's what happens here. You know, I wouldn't even go to his wake, funeral, you know, but we were friends our whole life. Yeah. And that's the type of stuff that's going on to this day. I mean, we could walk out that door and you know, you'll see it right now.
You talking to kids here in Charleston about this movie?
Yeah, we get some buzz here. Me and Brendan, we ran into a lot of controversy because at first people were like, oh, you can't talk about this, da-da-da-da-da. And we're like, you know what? Screw you. We're doing it. Like, we don't care. We're doing something creative. Plug. You guys want to stay in the street and go to jail and do the revolving door and then either OD and die, run with it. We're doing something creative and positive. Leave us alone. You know what I mean?
And that's the thing. Like, when John's been in prison, I've been in prison, and I don't care if you spent, you know, a day in prison or 10 years in prison. A day away from your family is a day away from your family that you never get back. So whether it's 10 years, 5 years, 3 years, those are days you never get back. So you got to take the positive out of being in prison, try to turn your life around, and do the right thing when you come home. So this, to me, was a blessing. You know, come on as a jail consultant, try to make it as real as possible for us. That's what I was asked by David and John. Absolutely, without a, you know, no problem.
So what's it like, all of you guys acting together?
You will never in the history of film see chemistry beyond mine, David, and Brendan's. The chemistry between the three of us is just such organic Boston street humor, organic Boston lifestyle. Not the tough guy gangster stuff that everyone does, but like jumping off a bridge into the polluted harbor.
And you're doing this stuff.
And the Boston Phoenix, they mentioned that, unlike, you know, actors and stuntmen and the other films that are going on in Boston right now, the lead cast members, me, David, and Brendan, and Oxymorons, are doing their own stunts, like shown here, and it shows pictures of us jumping off the bridge, off the Chelsea Bridge, a 35-foot bridge into the polluted channels of the Mystic River. You know, I mean, we were swimming in black water, you know?
Something on your ankle.
Oh, yeah, I still got stuff on my ankle that I'm getting rid of. Yeah. He had a hermit crab living in his nose.
It was a lot of fun, you know, and I wouldn't trade it in for anything because this is something that we did and no one can take it from us, you know, which I love.